Good evening. Thanks for coming tonight. I'm John Booker of LA Screenwriter. The show has been hailed by critics and fans alike as an exploration of depth consciousness, of mythology, of philosophy, spirituality, and an exploration of what does it mean to be human. Tonight we have the creators of the show with us from Netflix's The OA. Would you help me welcome to the stage the creators and star, Zal Batmanglitch and Britt Marling. Well, we've just watched the pilot episode of this amazing piece of art. We're going to get into a lot of different subjects of what the meanings may be behind some of these things, as much as you can talk about them. But can we begin by talking just a little bit about how this particular project came to be?
It's a long story. Do you want to start?
Well, yeah, I guess Britt and I went to the AFI, which is down the street. It's a film school, and I graduated with a directing degree, and I didn't know how to make movies. And you know, like, how do you get a directing job? And Britt wanted to be an actress, and so she had the idea, why don't we just teach ourselves how to write? And I was like, how do we teach ourselves how to write? And Britt had a lot of confidence that she could learn things. I didn't have that kind of confidence. So we set out to different libraries all over town, maybe the Beverly Hills Public Library, the Las Feliz Library, the Downtown Library, which is a really great one if you guys haven't been down there. And we taught ourselves over, I guess, 3 or 4 years how to write. And we wrote a script called Sound of My Voice that we were proud of. And we tried to get it made, but of course, no one wants to make a movie with a first-time director.
And an actress who isn't in SAG and hasn't even been in, like, a car commercial.
And so that proved hard. And then I think it was you, again, Britt, who decided to, like, why are we waiting for permission? Why don't we go make this? We'd met in college at Georgetown University making short films digitally. And sort of in 1998, something called Firewire was invented, so you could take a digital video and put it into your computer. And my buddy Mike Cahill and I were part of the beginning of the digital, you know, digital filmmaking. And Britt saw a film that we did, and she wanted to work with us, and we went on to make a couple films together that way. And Britt said, you know, 5 or 6 years later, why don't we just make Sound of My Voice that way? And we did. And we shot Sound of My Voice for $130,000 on 4 7Ds that we borrowed from different people. We were so broke that we would buy an Apple computer from an Apple store and then on the 13th day return it and go to another Apple store. This is a true story. And so we decided to submit to the Sundance Film Festival because, like, that would be a good way to put an endpoint on these projects. I don't know about you guys, but sometimes when you're working in such a vacuum, like, we didn't know anybody in the movie business, like, we just had a lot of dreams. Like, you need to create a sort of sense of structure for yourself so that you can just get through the day. And so Sundance was just a way to, like, end the chemical process. Like, this is when we're gonna finish this film. But then we got in, and people liked the movie. And we made a movie called The East, which we'd also written, and which I also directed and Britt starred in. But then we found that our worlds, both the world in Sound of My Voice, which is about a cult in the San Fernando Valley, and The East, which is about activists. I'm just thinking about how timely it is right now. We thought that those worlds were kind of bigger worlds than a two-hour movie. And so in 2012, when we were editing The East, we said, let's start coming up with a long format story. Do you want to finish it?
Idea, yeah. I think we'd reached a place where we felt like when we work together, it tends to be like very dense. Like there's a lot of ideas in there and they're big worlds and there's an interesting community and tribalism. So there's lots of characters. And I think we found that in the feature landscape, we'd spend the first 45 minutes setting up this world and the rules of the world and the character. And then suddenly you have like 30 minutes to play and then you've got to get out. And so I think we felt like maybe our storytelling is more suited to just more time. In fact, Sound of My Voice had been conceived of as a trilogy. I don't know what we were thinking. We couldn't even get the first one financed, and we were like, let's make three. So we never made the other two. But then I think we reached a place where we thought long format would be really interesting, and it was also a space that was letting in new voices in a way that it's sometimes hard in cinema. So we came up with this idea for the OA, and we spent a year and a half just telling each other the story out loud in Zal's apartment. Like we would just pace around the living room and sort of enact scenes, really.
Yeah, I mean, our dream was to make a mind bender, and the mind bender is uniquely suited for a long format, and yet the kind of economic realities of long format were that it was so rare that you would get a pilot, let alone get to a whole end of a first season, that people wouldn't spend the time, and I realize now why, they wouldn't spend the time figuring out the world. But we spent about 2 years figuring it out, not getting paid to figure it out, just because we like doing that. And and then we wrote a pilot. And then, you know, Netflix hadn't even made House of Cards when we started. So at the same time, sort of, we sent our ship out of a port and we kind of sailed into the middle of the water, not knowing what port would receive us. Like, I don't think that this show could go on HBO, at least not in the version that we made. Like, it would probably be somehow, the edges would be sharpened, and you know, maybe that's a good thing or maybe that's a bad thing. And so the beauty of wanting to make something completely unfettered and sort of not neutered, Netflix sort of arose as a harbor where they were willing to do that, willing to not only, because we talk about this, it's one thing to say you're a risk taker, and a lot of places will say, oh yeah, we're risky or we're edgy or any of these bad words. But you know, like we wanted to have our credits come in at 57 minutes in. That takes a lot of legal footwork, you know? And Netflix is amazing like that, where the people got excited. And I don't mean to make this an advert for Netflix. I'm not like, you know, very pro corporation, but in this case, you have a group of people whose the maverick quality is not just in the storytelling, but then also in the support legally, morally, you know, through the executives to kind of get something like that made. So, you know, that's a good feeling. I've never experienced that feeling before doing this kind of work.
Yeah, can you talk a little bit? Obviously, Netflix offers you the opportunity to, in some senses, make an eight-hour film, really, as opposed to just this episodic week-by-week television show. Some of the episodes, the first pilot episode's an hour and 11 minutes, then there's another episode that's like 40 minutes. And so how do you approach that, you know, as creators? Did you structure that up front, knowing where you wanted each episode to begin and end, or what was the creative process like in bringing that to the screen?
I think that's what was really exciting about this experience, is it felt like the first time we got to make something where the story was driving form. Like it wanted to end a chapter in a certain place, and so we ended it. And Netflix was excited about bending the rules that way. Like, there was no constraint on, oh, it needs to be this long, or you need to cut to a commercial here, so it's got to, you know, go to a high dramatic point here. It felt like we got to have the story tell itself. And so that was really exciting, because you could do things like meet some of your main characters 3 hours in. It's a much more novelistic approach, I think. So it's interesting.
Yeah, it's funny that in long format storytelling, you had to have all your main characters in that pilot before, which is just so unrealistic.
Because it was a proof of concept. And if like you didn't, if the proof of concept didn't work, then you weren't going any farther than that.
this, in some ways, for those of us who have sort of been following your work and seeing the films that came out, the OA feels like a chance to further explore these themes that seem to appear again and again in your work. So one of those themes is this idea of infiltration, you know, of somebody that's infiltrating some area, whether it be another dimension or whether it be a cult, but someplace that we're not supposed to be, infiltrating this new space. Can you talk a little bit, you know, do the themes come to you in before there's even a story involved, or do they arise naturally out of the storytelling? How does that work?
That's such a good question, because I think, you know, you realize after you've done it a few times that people will ask, where does the story come from? So then when you're trying to form a story again, you try to pay attention to see where does it actually come from? And we're in that right now. We're embarking on part two, and we are coming up with a story. And even as it's happening, I'm like, how is this happening? I think there's something complicated about the mythology of the artist, in which there's this idea that, like, it sort of things spring fully formed from the creator. To me, I think we feel it's much more of a like weather thing. It's something that's happening in the climate, and it's at best you're kind of a satellite dish or a receptor. You're just listening. You're trying to take something in, and then hopefully, I think if you get yourself in a sort of pure enough space, you know, something comes out. So I think the same themes kind of do. If you feel like you didn't quite get it right, you keep trying to hear it more clearly and articulate it better, and each time is a practice at that. I don't know, do you think that makes
sense? Well, yeah, I mean, I think that you're right that we don't believe that the artist is like divining something. We believe that like we'll share with you guys, you know, we're working on part two right now, and we just did this research trip, and we met people from all these different walks of life. We won't tell you what walks of life so that you won't know where the story goes. But we met people from all these different walks of life. And, you know, we went for about a week. And you know what? All these certain themes appeared, like between people that you would not think are connected. So something is happening. And then our job is to sort of take that clay and sort of say, well, what is happening? And of course, our own psychologies, our own senses of being infiltrators, you know, probably from birth or something, come in there. But we're trying to get that stuff away, actually, and try to get to what's happening and try to tell a story that matters. That means something to us, you know, trying to do something that has some sort of value. I mean, maybe not for everybody. Nothing can have value for everybody, but...
Well, it's interesting you say when you travel to these different places, you see these same themes arise. Carl Jung, you know, spoke of a collective unconscious. That seems to be something that appears again and again throughout your work, is this idea of the interconnectedness of all things and how what is seems to be coincidence maybe really isn't coincidence. And even with, you know, the characters that Britt portrays, there seems to be often this question in the audience's mind of, is she telling the truth? Is she who she says she is, or is she not? You know, this happens again and again in your work. Is this a value that you hold? Is it something that you're deliberate about? Do you believe in a collective unconscious that rises up in the work?
I think we definitely believe in a collective. I mean, I think that's why filmmaking is so attractive, is it, you literally cannot do it alone. Like, if you're a novelist or a sculptor, you know, it's about the pursuit of something maybe solitary, but you can't make the OA without 100 plus storytellers coming and joining you and telling the story through every prop, every, you know, piece of fabric somebody's wearing. I like living that way. To me, it just feels...
Yeah, I mean, like when we went on this research trip, we were meeting people from all different walks of life, and you do feel that there is some sort of thread, some sort of unconscious running through all of us. And then in terms of like the things that appear in our work, do do we think that, yeah, I think we are very interested in belief and faith. And I think if you try to look at those things too straight on, it's really hard to look at them straight on. So you kind of have to have a side glance. And in doing so, trust is a major part of it.
Yeah, and I think also, we were talking about this before, the power of ritual and the idea that the ritual of storytelling is interesting and important. And I think the OA is certainly about the idea of inventing myth, inventing a new myth that's maybe useful, drawing a group of people together in real time in a real space away from their smartphones who are connecting about something and who hopefully leave storytelling hour charged with something that feels outside themselves, you know.
But I think we also believe that storytelling has to leave just the storyteller. And it has to enter the audience, and that happens in the OA because, like, they have to believe even in the absence of evidence, or even if evidence is against the idea of believing it. But I think then our goal, whether intentionally or unintentionally, is that the audience then also mimics that and has to sort of believe it on their own, like, instead of being
handed proof of some kind.
Yeah, that the storytelling is complete in everybody else, not just from us, because it never was ours in the first place. I think that's something we believe in.
There's aspects of the show, such as the movements, which people have talked a lot about, that some have said echo in ancient Sufism. There was a belief that angels communicated with each other through movements, that they didn't have a spoken language. Are you guys intentionally bringing in, you know, research that touches these places, or do you come up with these ideas and just say, it'd be really neat if they did this and then this and then this? You know, how does that come about?
I didn't know. Did you know about angels talking and movements? I mean, I guess we agree. I don't know.
That goes back to the collective unconscious. I mean, I think everybody's drawing from the same well, and certainly the well is ancient, you know, so I don't think it's really original in that sense. Like, it's, but there is something that we were interested in, which is the idea of, I think we're living in a time where we're all very stuck in our heads, and technology is sort of reinforcing that concentration of logic. And it felt important to tell a story about dropping back into your body and into emotion and into feeling and integrating that part of intelligence with the rest of how we think of intelligence. And so I think the movement sort of came out of that.
In building on this idea of the body, Britt, you portray this character that through part of the series is blind and through part of the series is not blind. How in the world do you prepare for a character that sometimes we're supposed to believe can see and sometimes we're supposed to believe cannot? What's that preparation like?
Terrifying. Just totally. We got to, you know, it was such a marathon just to write all eight up front, because we wrote all eight up front and then we cross-boarded it, or we shot it like an 8-hour film. So when we'd finished writing, the exhaustion was so intense, and then we had like very little time to prep, and you can't really prep an 8-hour film. Like, at best you can get some of it prepped, and then you're kind of doing this rolling pre-production. And somewhere in there we finally got to New York, where we decided to shoot, and I set my bags down and we were shooting in like 2 weeks, and I was like, oh my God, I have to play this part. And I started reading the script thinking about that for the first time, because when we're telling the story, we're just thinking about, like, how do you tell a good story? So that was scary. And then I met this really amazing man named Joe Stretchy, who started to go blind when he was 19 and was completely blind by his mid-20s, and it was a genetic thing. And he was awesome. And we would meet in Manhattan, on the Lower East Side, and I would put a blindfold on and walk out and meet him. And he taught me how to cane around Manhattan and how to buy groceries and we made an omelet together. I mean, we would do stuff all day long, and I'd never take off the blindfold. And in the beginning, when you start doing it, it is, I mean, properly terrifying, because you lose sense of the grid, like, right away. You're just lost in the dark. It really is a kind of prison and it feels really isolating. And then I learned from him things like making the traffic, which you would think would be the scariest thing, your best friend, because the audio of the cars is like a line going by. And so you can suddenly think about geographic space and depth again. And so all that stuff, I mean, just became about learning through the body again. Because I don't think, there's some things I think you can't prepare for intellectually. It's like you just got to go put your body through it. And then I'll be like, oh, my body knows that, you know, if you're blind, you don't feel things with your fingers because that's how you read, you know, so your fingers are like your eyes. And so when you feel for things, you feel like this so that you're not damaging your, so these kinds of things you just learn and then you incorporate it. And then I think it just comes up on set. You don't even have to think about it anymore. It's.
But that's a neat part for me is, you know, it's always sad every time when, you know, we've spent so long getting the boulder up the hill of just getting the project greenlit, then like writing it. And then all of a sudden we go in these different directions. Like I prep as a director and Britt prepares as an actor. And we sort of meet up once in a while. And one of the cool things was Britt was working with Joe a lot and they would go on these 4 or 5 hour excursions and Britt would not take off the blindfold. And then she sort of shared it with me and I put the blindfold on and she took my arm and I went down one New York City block and then we went into a bodega and I can still remember that experience. It was such a nice and interesting feeling. Like I've been to this one bodega, but I can't tell you what it looks like. I mean, we can imagine it, but it's an interesting experience. I think you guys should all try it. It's a profound thing to take away a sense. It stays with you.
Mm. Zal, how do you approach an 8-hour film, basically, as a director? How is that different than, you know, the 90-minute, 2-hour films that you've been directing previously before this?
Well, in a lot of ways, it was similar. Like, I had an amazing DP and an amazing production designer. This guy named Lowell Crawley was the DP, and the production designer was a guy named Alex DiGirlando. And they're both really brilliant people, and the three of us really had fun sort of just learning the story. You try to learn the story so well that like you can tell it out of order, which is what we shot for 86 days, totally out of order. But once you get the story and you feel it in your bones and your collaborators are feeling it and then their collaborators are feeling it, like, you know, by the time the on-set dresser is feeling it in their bones, then there's a nice feeling. It feels like you're on this expedition, this trek together. And then certain things come to you. I mean, what's cool about the OA is that really, like, the props person or the costumes person or whoever would read the script and they would just feel it and they would just, you know, it was like an improv. They would say yes, and I feel like we felt that between ourselves. And I know the story seems very strange, but I think on a granular level, it actually makes a lot of sense, and it did for all the people who were working on it. It was very hard, but it was a very nice vibe on set. Everybody.
You know, there seems to be a real cohesion in the various departments, especially around some of the visuals. For example, there's the spiralic staircase that goes down into the underworld in the basement, again, which is very mythological, very depth psychology. There's this running stream, you know, that goes through the basement. With the basement in particular, the glass cells, all of it, with the basement in particular, how much of that is in your head and how much of that do you say, here's kind of the basic idea and then you guys just turn the crew loose to come up with something and bring you ideas? How does that process work?
It's amazing that you bring that up because, I mean, there were aspects of the basement that were realized in our minds in this writer's room, but largely, they were always glass and everyone was separated and that was important, but...
And there was a river that ran in the back.
But initially they were in a line. And when we gave the script to Alex, you know, there were all these conditions of things with the characters, like Homer's got to pass the bag downstream, like OA has to pass it upstream, like at some point Scott and OA need to be next to each other, but then later Renata comes. There were all these rules about the storytelling.
Homer and OA had to be between Scott's cage. There were all these parameters. And then we got to New York and Alex, who knows me really well, we're very close.
He's a production designer.
Yeah. we're sitting like we're sitting now, and I'm me, and you guys are Alex, and Alex said to me at some point, he goes, "Stand up." So I stood up, and he's like, "You're in the cell." And I was like, "What?" He's like, "Look down." And he put this masking tape on the ground, and there was a triangle. And he's like, "You're away." And he's like, "I'm Homer now. I'm in Homer's cell." And he's like, "You see this masking tape that goes like this? That's the river. That's the stream." And I was like, "Whoa." I both like this idea and don't like this idea, which is what's true anytime something is new. You know, I think we have to all remember that in life. And also with this story, it's like, at first you're like, whoa. And then of course, it was always that way. What were you going
to
say, sir?
Just that gets back to the idea of the collective unconscious, collective filmmaking. It's like that was a moment where Alex is, he comes in as a storyteller and he writes the story further than we ever could have written it. And that, I feel like, is the thing you're always looking to do, is like form these tribes in which the story becomes greater than the sum of its parts, because it's not, doesn't belong to any one person. Alex definitely is like that.
Britt, as you or a part of this creative process, these ideas that the two of you are spinning around, it's got to cross your mind at some point, I'm going to have to embody this character. Do you try and keep that completely out of your mind as you're creating the story, or do you embrace that? What's your relationship like with the character as you're creating the story?
It's funny. I mean, it sounds weird to say this, but like, I think that I just completely compartmentalize it. It's like when we're in the writing phase, we are just writing, because otherwise you'd be like, I don't know about this moment where I'm fighting with a Rottweiler. Like,
or getting my head drowned, which was a real effect and not a VFX. You know, that is the real deal. And let me just say, when you're watching that, it's completely real, and I'm not gonna tell on the boys, but yeah. Well, let's just say Britt held her breath longer than anyone. And the crew, I mean, people walked off set. It was so hard to watch. And that is, that you guys, to understand Britt is to understand that she put her head in this thing. And it seems okay or whatever, but when you put your head in that thing, you can't hear anything. Everything is echoed. And then that water is really filling up. And then she's acting on top of that when she looks Hap dead in the eye. Go home and watch it again, because
don't.
That is real. And it is, I mean, people on the veteran New York crew walked off the stage. It was so hard to watch.
All that to say that in the writer's room, you might not put yourself in that situation. You'd be like, I think in this scene, she's got her feet up, she's got a bathrobe on, she's eating little ice cream treats.
But you forget it. Like, we're in the research phase right now too, and we're not thinking about, oh, it's gonna be freezing if we shoot at night in this place we wanna shoot. I mean, you know that.
You're just thinking like the fog would be so beautiful when it's coming off the bay and you can't see anyone in it, you know, and it's, yeah. So, but later when I read the script and was like, oh no, I've got to play this, and we've got to play it while, and he has to direct while also show running, which is just a completely different set of skills on top of that. Then I had a real, oh shit moment. And, but I think, you know, something, maybe when you're writing, you are internalizing a lot of it on some level. I think that some of it does enter you in a way, even though you have to be as able to play Steve or Betty Broderick Allen in your mind as you're writing. But some part of it does enter. So I think it is, later it becomes easier when you transfer.
But Britt also does a lot of work. Like, you know, Britt would spend hours, like maybe 5 or 6 hours, just at, you know, once everything's in place and Alex and Lowell and the rest of the crew and I are prepping, Britt's sitting sometimes in a quiet room just meditating on the character and building your imagination. And so one time when we were in New York, we went to go see a friend's movie at Lincoln Center and we shared a cab. And Britt started talking to me about the first time as a little girl that she leaves her father and he puts her on that plane to go to boarding school in America. And that she, oh man, it's making me emotional to think about it. That you did, do you want to tell the story, or do you want me to tell the story?
You can tell it.
that she didn't little Nina didn't want to cry in front of her father because she thought it would make him sad. And she tried to guess as best where he was when she got on top of the stairs of the plane. And she tried to wave to him, but she didn't know if she got it right. And then she got on the plane and the doors closed and then she cried. And it's like, I'm sitting there being like, we have to put that in the show, but the show's already like well gone. So like, you know, all the pieces are in place. So this is all the stuff that you guys only feel, but we'll never see. And that's the amount of work that Britt does. And it's an amazing thing to be witness to.
I can't believe you even remember that story.
Oh, man, that stayed with me. I didn't tell it well now, but
it did tell it well.
It really stayed with me.
He told it well. Yeah, I did.
Britt, someone asking the questions here, this could be completely false, so you never know when the internet's telling you the truth or lying, but in your IMDb profile, it says that you taught yourself to write. True?
Definitely true. I mean, I think, you know, Zal was saying earlier, I mean, I studied economics in school, so like I learned a lot about spreadsheets. I'm like really good with Excel, which comes in handy when you're trying to figure out how to produce stuff later because nobody will give you money to make anything. You can just keystroke your way through budgets because you actually know that. But no, later on, I think when we realize that no one's going to ever hand you the job you want or even let you intern for it, you know, and especially if you're a young woman and you come out to LA, it's a, you know, I mean, it's really, there are not very many great parts written for women. There are a lot of really great actresses competing for them who are already very well known. And so it's really up to you. And on some level, it feels like there's a bit of a moral imperative to write great parts for women because the storytelling is so unbalanced. And so I think we both just felt, wow, if we want to do these jobs, we want to be storytellers as an actor and as a director, we have to start where storytelling begins, which is with writing. And we read a lot of screenwriting books. I read Silence of the Lambs like 500 times. It's a great screenplay. I read a lot of plays, and we wrote a lot of really bad things, you know? That's how it begins. You write a lot of stuff that you show your friends and they're like
But Britt taught me that, you know, it's a lot like surfing. It's like you can't just get on the board and like ride the wave. Like that's not going to happen. You've got to do it slowly, and you've got to be willing to fall and make an ass out of yourself and be willing to say, hey, it's hard to start something. You know, you got to give it 2 or 3 years.
Or seven.
No, 2 or 3 to even get up on the board, I think, and like ride that wave, like, yeah. Let alone like get into the deep end of the ocean.
But what's cool is that if you learn how to surf, you know, that's a thing you can try to get better at for a lifetime. And I think the thing that's amazing about writing is you're never really good at it. It's something you're always just trying to get better at communicating more nearly the thing that we feel or mean. And That's to me, that's exciting that there's this craft that it would be impossible to master. Like, I feel like a surgeon on some level after the like 400 time, you know, the 400th time he's done a brain surgery, like, you know, a lot of what that looks like and you can anticipate it and there's a learning curve that helps you. But with writing, I think it's like there are no tricks. There's no real learning curve. Like every time you sit down to do it, you feel vulnerable and scared and like a fraud. And somehow you have to hold your own hand or hold your partner's hand and walk through that vulnerability and terror and just see if you can come up with something to put on the page that feels true. As you were saying, what did you say earlier about mythos?
More than true.
More than true, yeah.
What does that look like logistically with the two of you? Is you're walking around the room spinning these ideas, or one of the two of you sitting down at a computer and sort of capturing those? Does somebody go capture them later? How does that process work creatively when you're co-writing something that is this massive of a story?
You know, something that Zal taught me a lot about is the power of oral storytelling. I think in the beginning I was very into like writing things down, and then, but that can sort of become like a dead thing. Like you nail it down too early and then it's like text on this page and you feel very committed to it because but the thing about oral storytelling is amazing is that as you tell it day in and day out, the stuff that isn't good falls away because you just can't remember it. And the stuff that's great sticks because you need it to get to the next beat in the story. And
yeah, it's like telling a joke. Yeah. It's like a lot of it is getting the math right in telling the joke. And when you say math, it sounds technical, and maybe it is, but like a joke, it's an emotional art form, and you get better at it. Like you say something and it sticks with your partner, you know?
You see, like, they laugh or the light goes on in their eyes and you're like, oh, that part connects, and then you keep that part. And I think before we've ever opened Microsoft Word to outline, or let alone final draft to write a scene, we've told the story to each other back and forth hundreds of times, and to other people.
And there are those firsts,
yeah.
You know, like the first time you realize they need five people, there's someone on the stairs, you know, someone's coming up. Is it the boy that he punched, you know? And then you see Steve react, oh, it must be the boy that he punched, you know? And then you're blinded by the light. And then one day, at some point, we said, no, it's Betty Broderick Allen. And, you know, you just know, you get goosebumps because you're like, of course, that's the fifth person. Like, it just, you know, and then now you have to go build the math so that it makes total sense. You know,
you have to write the scene where she's on her laptop Googling, and you have to make it feel real that she did that, which means you have to go back to the scene where she's at the parent-teacher conference, and like what happened in that room where she resisted but was somehow struck. And
Britt, one of our guests tonight named Tatum, says, I admire you for how you made your way in the industry. As an actress in her 30s, I'm finally stepping into making my own work to submit to festivals. Can you shed some light on the path, or any tips or advice?
Oh, that's a good question. Where is Tatum? Hi, nice to meet you. That's awesome that you're... Yeah, it's really exciting. I'm trying to think of the thing that would have been the most useful to hear. And I feel like it's that, there's all this emphasis placed on the individual, you know, culturally. And the thing that I think I felt very lucky that I had was the sense of community. You know, Zal spoke earlier about our friend Mike, and the three of us met in school and we were making these films together, and we had a moment where we finally said, forget auditioning for parts, like forget trying to be accepted or validated. And I think when you're young and beginning, you really just want someone to say, oh my God, I see you, you're good, you're great. Like, here's this part, or here's this opportunity. And I kept finding that not only did that not happen, but you don't need it. You know, I think that was the thing that switched in my brain, was this idea that you don't have to wait for permission to do something. Like, we just started making films in a handmade small way, like asking friends for things, stealing locations from friends who worked, you know, we want to shoot in a restaurant, like who do we know who works at a restaurant who can like get us in after hours on the sly, like all these kinds of things. And I think as we were making those works, it was never about the end game. Like, we'd stopped caring about that. It wasn't about infiltration anymore. We stopped trying to get somewhere or get in the castle with its like gate and the moat and the fire-breathing dragons outside, you know? We were just like, we're gonna go in the woods and do this other thing. And I think that's when the work becomes imbued with a kind of magic that happens when people are making something for the love of it. You just, because you want to that day, because it feels great to come and tell a story with a group of people. And when that's in the work, it ends up being, of course, the thing where everyone in the castle is like, let's down the bridge. And they're like, oh no, come in, you know? Because it has something true and like usually deeply felt in it. And I feel like the people I've witnessed who have been able to begin to make a living doing this kind of work have all gone off into the woods and just made things in their own way, by their own rules, for themselves. And then eventually always those people within the castle will start, you know, they'll send a scouting party after you. You're like, I see your smoke signal. Yeah. What are they doing in the woods? You know? And then you have to be really careful, like, not to go too far into the castle, like maybe just make one trip and like grab some things from them and then go back out to the woods. And
yes.
Zol, there's a lot among us tonight who are also, you know, trying to get projects off the ground, trying to get their story to some sort of audience. Is someone who has who's managed to do that and have great success at that. Any advice on how people can approach bringing their story to a wider audience?
Yeah, I think that sometimes we look at a film festival as if it's this thing that's like run by the government and like, you know, like the Electoral College, like it's gonna have these rules. A film festival is a fashion show. And you are the fashion designer, you know, like anything goes. If the festival is also an art form, right? They're trying to tell a story through what they program. So there's a story happening all around us. There's a really interesting story happening. You know, when a movie like Moonlight wins Best Picture, it says, come on, there's a story happening. Like, can you hear that story? And I guess everybody's job out there, all of our jobs, is to get quiet and try to hear the story that's happening. It's sort of like an improv troupe. You know, the rule in improv is yes and, but you also need to know when to come into the improv. And so I think if you really listen to the story that's happening, to the improv that's happening, you'll know when to jump in and you'll know the right thing to say. Look, it might not work. The improv might fall flat, but it might also really work, and then it's kind of magic. So I don't think you can look at a film festival as someone who's going to tell you you're good, you're not good, you can do this, you can't do this, because no one knows that kind of stuff. But they are involved in a storytelling themselves. And if you can sort of connect with that storytelling, either unconsciously, like we did with Sound of My Voice, where we went off into the woods, or I think there's a way to sort of look at it consciously and say, I'm noticing these threads, both in my own life, sociopolitically, emotionally, but also in the storytelling that's happening. And maybe you can tell a story that adds to that.
Like, I guess the year Sound of My Voice was programmed, Martha May Marcy May Marlene was also talking about cults. There was another film that was dealing with cults, the name I can't remember. So there was something in the air that was about, like, what does it mean to, what is a cult? What is an outsider religion? Like, why is there some desire for people to get together? And so the programmers are like trying to string those beads together. And so I think Saul brings up a really good point when it's about sort of, I think, maybe tapping into that in some way. Yeah.
One thing that you have managed to do in your work is bring characters to the screen that we have not seen given much voice before. You were talking about, you know, giving women strong characters to portray. We also see in the OA, we have a trans character that, you know, is not defined by the gender identity at all. It's a character who's just, you know, a part of the story with everyone. We also have a bully who is made to be somehow understood. So we have these characters that we don't see given a lot of voice in our culture. Is that something that's important to you, or is that something that, again, just seems to spring organically out of the storytelling, or are you intentional about that?
I think that's something that is very intentional. I think, for instance, Betty Broderick Allen is a character who, I mean, I think we probably all had an algebra teacher like her somewhere along, and it's hard for us to see that woman because she isn't really given space in the cinematic or the moving image experience. And so I think we do try to think about people who are left out of the story as the sort of, you know, broad mainstream sense, and think about how to pull those people into the story.
And it's hard. I mean, we have to work harder at it. You know, and even when we wrote Buck, who was a 14-year-old Asian American female to male trans character, which is a very specific character, and I don't know exactly how it came to us, but when we wrote that, there are a lot of people who said that you're not going to find that. You know, you're not going to find that person who can then act. People will tell you that all the time. And you have to keep fighting. So, you know, it's easy at any point to get derailed. So you see why it's so hard for it to come onto the screen. But I think that we can all be vigilant and we can work harder at trying to be even more inclusive, trying to find more people whose stories aren't readily available. I think we're all really hungry for that experience, and the internet sort of connects it. I mean, I think that there's a positive side to the internet.
You've just finished the third season of the OA. You're looking back, and you look at the first... I'm speaking in faith. There's a third season,
and
I believe.
I'm just thinking about our health.
At the end of the third season, someone asks you, is there a moment from the first season that just stands out, that is representative of that first season? Is there a story or a moment you'll just never forget from that first season? What is that moment much later that you'll be looking back on?
I'm so curious what she's going to say.
I think you probably, I don't know if this will be a surprise or not. For me, I guess both within the narrative itself, but also in the experience of making it, is the end of chapter 5 when the OA and Homer find the movements for the first time. And I was terrified that day. I was really, really scared because Emery and I had been training and learning these movements with Ryan Heffington and with Dina, one of his choreographers here in LA, and then again in New York, and we'd spent a long time on them, but we hadn't really done them for anybody. And the thought of doing it on set with in front of this crew who were all, everybody was feeling a little bit like, this is maybe the thing that is not gonna come together. And the whole story is built around it. And I just remember thinking, in those moments when you're really scared, I think you draw a lot on the performers around you. And Scott Brown, who's Will Brill, I mean, this is what's amazing about when you're on set and everyone really gives a shit. You know, he'd been shooting, it's cold, he's naked, he's on the floor, there's this sticky blood around, and he could have wrapped himself in a robe or been like, you know what, a stand-in is going to be there for this. And instead, he was there and naked on the ground, even though the camera is not on him. And I remember just like looking at his body and really feeling like, I just have got to believe that this person that I care about is dead on the floor right now. And then somewhere, that grief has to be so real that when I stand up and move, it's completely unconscious. It isn't even about movements or the story working or not working or people getting it or not getting it. It's just like you move like that because if you don't, you feel like you will die just like he did. And that you never know on the day if that is going to show up, you know, if the feeling is going to show up or if you're going to be left hanging. And I think because of Will and because of Emery, it's like we showed up for each other. And when I looked at Emery and he was moving too, and everything came out as an improvisation. I mean, we didn't intend to have a dialogue, you know, as a couple about a betrayal, you know, me angry that he'd betrayed me, him asking for forgiveness, this sort of back and forth. But by the time we went through that scene, I felt like I had touched something that I could never touch again and that I did not expect ever to when we were writing it. And that was
I don't know about what the world experiences, but for us, those of us, the crew, and those of us who were there, I mean, I've known Britt for 15 years, and it's in those moments that you know, you've known someone for 15 years and then they just stand up and they do something and you're like, whoa, I am meeting you for the first time. And it was so intense. I turned around and an electrician was crying, and I, you know, I'm not a good enough director yet to be able to have captured it fully. When it happened live there in that basement that Alex had built, like, I thought, you know what? We're on the right path, even if it's gonna take us years and years and years and years to really understand what it is that we're doing or get good enough at transmitting it. Like, we're doing something that is stirring something in me that I had never felt before. And it was introducing me to the person that I work with every day. And that's, I mean, what more can you ask for?
Do you have people coming up to you in airports and mimicking the movements, or is that, has that been a thing?
Yes. Yeah.
No, I haven't had that. We have had a lot of people give us books in airports. A lot of people have given Britt a book and said, I can't believe I'm seeing the OA. But I was having dinner with Jason. The only time I've seen the movements done, I was having dinner with Jason. And we got up, Jason, who plays Hap in the show, and we got up from dinner and we were getting our coats at the coat check, and this group of three people went and it scared the shit out of me. I was like, whoa. And Jason's like, happens all the time. So I guess you're used to it too. I have to be with you guys to get it, but like, whoa.
And Jason loves it.
Jason loves it. Of course he does.
There's a line from one of the episodes that I wrote down that I just have to ask you, because some of the writing in this show is so good and so tweetable. It's just small, you know, Prince. We find out that Homer's coach once said to him, "Knowledge is a rumor till it lives in the body." I see.
No, it's funny though. We reach a place where I don't think we have any idea where, who said what. I mean, that's the.
No, that one's definitely yours because I didn't understand it for a long time, and I love. I get it now. I get it now. But that, yeah.
I mean, the idea was definitely there. I remember us all talking a lot about this question of why we hate the body so much in this country. Like why we are so afraid of our own form and how much maybe we're taught to hate our bodies, because if you don't like yourself, then you buy more stuff. That's usually how it sort of goes. And so I know that we were very deliberately trying to dig after this idea of like things that your body knows before you know it consciously. Yeah. And I think that happens a lot. You know, I had a friend who was having a series of panic attacks for a period and later made a very big decision and changed her life, you know, the direction of her life. And I realized now that the panic attacks were about her body trying to alert herself to the fact.
In her panic attacks, she was immobile.
Yeah, she couldn't move. She couldn't move. Yeah, they would render her sort of. And then she made this really hard choice and she changed the direction and sort of focus of her life.
And they've gone away.
And I thought, oh, that was actually not the body terrorizing her. It was the body being like, stop, don't do this. Like, I know your mind, your rational, logical, conscious mind hasn't reached this place yet, but, you know, the body has, and it's going to like hold you until it's going to alert you to the fact that the correct course is this way. So I don't know. I think there's something to that. I think we're trying to figure that out.
I think it's so true. Like I remember making my thesis film at AFI and I got, it was like a 6-day shoot and I got sick for 3 of the days and it was really hard. And I thought, how am I ever going to really do this professionally? You know, we shot for 86 days. I wasn't sick one day. I mean, sometimes I would look at sickness in the eye and be like, I get you. I get what you're saying, but we got to keep telling this story. And then I thought, oh, I'd get sick when we finished shooting, but I didn't. And, you know, we went through all of post. And I think that you're having this relationship with your body that we a lot of times don't, you know, watch me get sick for like 3 months next year.
Oh my God, no, we have to write the show again. So just we'll both stare sickness in the eye and be like, the peace. See you in 5 years, hopefully. Yeah.
Episode 8, the ending of this, this issue that is a big issue in culture, you know, with a school shooting. Is this something that comes early in the process? Is this something that you're waiting until the end to figure out how you're going to end it? At what point do you have some sense of how this 8-hour story is going to conclude, at least for this season?
I think there was always the idea that this woman who had a very had a traumatic experience would come and find this group of boys who were inside their own trauma of coming of age, and that there would at some point be a break where you doubt would be introduced and you wouldn't know if everything she had told you was, you know, true or not, and that in that later the boys would face a moment, a very traumatic moment, and what she had passed on to them in the mythology of that story would come to the surface and express itself and be meaningful to them in that moment.
Yeah, I mean, just thinking about it now, it's funny that you say it that way. It's like the most unimaginable horror for a young woman is to get kidnapped, you know? And of course, young men get kidnapped all the time too. But I think also that young men are very involved in the trauma of high school shootings, not only because, of course, both men and women experience high school shootings, but men are usually the perpetrators. So whenever a young man reads about it or sees it on television, they have to also put themselves in the shoes of that. I mean, it becomes a very complicated thing. So I think it's also about this woman's trauma, a female trauma coming against a male trauma that I think.
And then something in, I loved what you said earlier about the difference between logos. Will you say that again?
Yeah, that logos represents the literal truth and mythos is the mythological truth that is more than true.
Yeah, I love that idea, because the idea that there's a myth truth that is more than true, I think in that moment the boys realize whether every fact is verifiable or not, there is a myth truth that is more true. And I think there's something that she gave them from her own trauma that for them meets that moment. So that was always there.
Someone who we work with played a podcast for me the other day. And in the podcast, a young woman who practices Buddhism said that when she first started practicing Buddhism, forgive me if I get it wrong to the young woman, but when she first started practicing Buddhism, the term loving kindness would make her very uncomfortable. And now she tells her students, can you sit in it for one extra second of that uncomfort? Can you sit in it? And she said on this podcast that watching the end of the OA felt like that for her, that moment in the school shooting. She's like, I had all these competing emotions and it was very uncomfortable and I wanted to say no and laugh and cry and all these things. And could I just sit in that moment for one extra second? And that's interesting to me, because I think about how I have to do that all the time in my own life.
Last question. Is there anything you can tell us about season two of the OA?
Well, can tell you that parts of it are set in San Francisco.
That's something.
And that's where we were on our research trip. But that's really about it.
Yeah, it's both, you know, it's a part two. So we see it as like, you know, its own work, but it's also, of course, part of this larger story that we spent those 2 years figuring out. We do know where it goes. Hopefully it'll work. I mean, who knows?
Well, on behalf...
It's scary every time.
On behalf of OA fans all over the world, thank you for the gift you've given us of this show. Join me in thanking them tonight.
Thank you, guys.